Hi, Rich. Hi, Adam. My name's Tristan. I'm calling you from the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Coast Salish people in Vancouver, B.C. I'm a dual citizen of the U.S. and Canada, and I've lived in both, so I've been comparing and contrasting the two countries for some time now. I've been wondering if there's some cultural root difference that could explain why our value systems are manifested in policy and behavior so differently, almost to the point that Americans appear to champion freedom but reject responsibility, when Canadians generally accept freedom and responsibility as two sides to the same coin. I'm thinking, for example, how as Americans, we want the right to bear arms, but not the universal background checks or common sense restrictions. We want the freedom to run a business, but not so much the responsibility of dealing with the waste byproducts of production. We want to move fast and break things in the tech world, but we don't want to take responsibility for how that affects society. We want the right to vote and are outraged at the thought of foreigners interfering in our elections, but we interfere with and overthrow other governments. We want to use the fast lane to pass slower drivers, but we won't move over for others. I'm wondering if you think there's something cultural that is uniquely American to account for this. Love the show. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tristan. I feel like this could be a whole college course. Mm. Like you could spend a semester on this question.
Why Canadians are better than Americans?
No, not that.
Oh, sorry.
But certainly, you know, to answer his question, is there a cultural difference? 100% there is.
Yeah.
Like America, you know, yeah, America. Yeah. Like that's what this is about, right?
Just what you were talking
about. Yeah, it's what we were talking about. What is it about America and the American sensibility and, you know, our shared history that leads to, you know, those observations, which I think are astute that Tristan made. Mm. And, you know, when you trace it back, to echo what we were just talking about, like our culture is premised on this idea of liberty, and baked into that is this sense of self-sufficiency and manifest destiny, this idea that your future rests on your shoulders, mm-hmm. you know, literally don't tread on me, you mm-hmm. know, like don't tread on me, get out of my business, get out of the way.
Yeah.
We came here from England to escape a certain, you know, certain aspects of religious repression and taxation. And we wanted to be left alone to do what we wanted to do. And I think the genetic material of that has been passed on generation after generation after generation. It's so woven into the fabric of our culture. And part of that is what makes us great. You know, it's what makes us different. It's what makes this experiment like so compelling and dynamic. But there's also a part of it that's incredibly dysfunctional, and we're seeing that dysfunction metastasize in certain ways right now. It's different right now. Like we were talking about, crises used to unite us,
yeah.
right? Like what happened when we were heading into World War II and all the women had to go into the factories and they converted the automotive factories into, you know, making airplanes and making munitions and all these sorts of things. Or, you know, the New Deal with FDR where, you know, we just marshaled incredible reserves to create these programs to lift people up from the bottom. You know,
yeah.
like all these things, there's so many examples over the history
yes.
over the history of our country where we were able to, you know, unite in times of strain to solve our shared problems for the common good. And now the crises that used to unite us seem to divide us.
Mm-hmm.
They become partisan, they become acrimonious, they become feeding grounds for, you know, political talking points and arrows slung. And social media plays a big part on this
yes.
by really tapping into people's fears, by activating their subconscious in a way that weaponizes ideas and pits us against ourselves. And I think, you know, another aspect of it is this idea that a very American idea of zero-sum game, right? Like baked into don't tread on me is like, this is mine, yours is there, you can't have what's mine. And if you're winning, then I'm losing. And I think we have a leader at the moment who, you know, exemplifies this idea, like nobody else can win except him. There are no, you know, there are winners and there are losers. And we, you know, the idea that we can all win together is not part of that mentality, the zero-sum sensibility. And that my responsibility only extends to myself, my needs, and that of my family alone. Meanwhile, as we modernize and we specialize, we've become more and more alienated from each other. We've lost, you know, our connection with our neighbors. We've experienced this denigration, this demise of community as we move towards this cul-de-sac culture where we lock ourselves in our cars and our homes. There's an isolationism that is at play here that I think you can layer on top of this sense, this false sense of American sort of superiority and entitlement. Like, yeah, like how dare anybody, you know, mess with our elections while we're doing who knows what in the third world, but that's fine because we're America, right?
Right.
This idea of American exceptionalism. And that's starting to fracture. You know, I think we're seeing it's like there is this unmistakable sense that like we're like Rome in the final days before the collapse. Like these systems don't last forever.
No.
And our system is flawed, highly flawed.
And the way that the systems were put in place also was kind of obviously flawed and problematic and evil in certain ways, and who was treated with fairly by the law and who still is.
Right.
But, you know, in terms of just going to the core of the question of Canada versus America, what makes it different? And I've never lived in Canada, so it would be hard for me to know, but a few things kind of stand out. Two of them are kind of policy and one is more media. But first of all, we just had this big Supreme Court decision when Obama was still in office that made corporations individuals.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think many countries in the world treat businesses as individuals. They don't give the same rights to corporations that they're supposed to give to individuals. It's crazy. Corporations are not individuals. They're businesses and they should be held to a different standard. Canada, to my knowledge, does not treat businesses that way. It's the same thing with Gavin Newsom and what happened with homeowners and trying to get them to throw their trash out. Canada gets corporations to throw their trash out a little bit better than we do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think Manifest Destiny existed there too. I think, First Nations, as they're called in Canada, Indigenous people were treated very poorly and were eradicated there too. So that happened. But in terms of legally what's been going on, corporations have more to answer for than they do in this country. They also have a parliamentary government, which means that if you win the prime minister is elected through their parties. The parties are elected and the leader of the party becomes the prime minister, as far as I know. And if you win in a parliamentary process, if you win by a narrow margin, you are then tasked with creating a coalition government with people who are maybe your political opponents and getting enough people in place to actually support your government. That means that coalition building is baked into the process. That's the same process England has, the same process Australia has. We don't have that process. I'm not arguing that that's a better process, but there is a coalition building, a communal, having to see each other eye to eye and meet in the middle. It's baked into the way they create their laws in Canada. We don't have that here. It's winner take all here, holding hostage by the power of the Senate or whatever it might be.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be, you're supposed to come correct and meet and compromise, but not. Mm-hmm. But that's not been happening lately.
No, I mean, first of all, we're not a democracy. We're a democratic republic.
Yeah.
There's a difference. I don't think we talk enough about that, like the republic aspect of how our government is structured. But what we've seen in the last several decades is this explosion in executive powers, like this expansion of the executive branch that I think exceeds what the forefathers would have ever predicted. There's supposed to be a very finely tuned balance between the three branches of government. And now it's just all about the executive and it's all about the president. So I think the president has too much power. Meanwhile, with the rights that have been vested in corporations matched by the way that we structure campaign finance, we've created a situation in which lobbyists actually hold the most power. They're making all the money, and they're the ones who are dictating policy at the highest level by getting politicians to do the bidding of these corporations, which are treated as individuals. And thus, we create a system in which the rights of these corporations are paramount to the rights of citizens. And that's led us to this place where we are unable to care for our commons because our priority is making sure that business is growing and that business is thriving.